You're watching Channel 6 in Woodstock. Woo!
Bart, how you doing?
Hi, Manny, what are you doing?
I'm cutting the ceiling out over here. You know that Peter Max picture I got?
Yeah?
I'm taking it out.
Why?
Well, I want to come up. Come on up. I want to take it over in the back building. I want to put it on the wall over there.
Oh, that's nice. We'll be right up.
Come on up. Take a look at this. This is really something. Hey.
What's the story of this ceiling?
I'm feeling real good about this whole thing. Well, and here's what happened. In 1977, one July 4th weekend, I think it was a weekend, John Angiodakis and Peter Max and Peter's lady, Roseanne, came to visit. John brought them up. They were hanging around over at the lake having a good time. Peter's an old friend of mine as well, and they came up. And while we were hanging around in this area, this was one room. I had a divider here, and we were all hanging around together and feeling pretty good. John said to Peter, "Hey, Peter, what kind of guy are you? Your old friends, why don't you draw something for Manny?" That's exactly how it happened, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. I said, "Nah, don't ask Peter for any favors like that. You know, he doesn't like to do things like that." But before I knew it, he was looking around for things to write with, you know, to draw with. "Come on, Peter, come on, draw something." So Peter said, all right, he embarrassed Peter into it. And then Peter said, all right, and he went into the center here. This is how he started the picture. You stop me if I'm not remembering it right. He started it here. He started it here, this lady here. There's her eye, and you look at it from this position. There's a large head. Here's the nose and the lips and the chin. He was drawing this lady right here, and this is a lady he does a lot in his art. And he says, "I got an idea, Manny, I got an idea." He says, I want to give you the center of the universe, you know. And then he went over here, and I said, "What is that?" And he said, that is God. That's what's the difference what that is? I'm giving it to you." And he went off into this corner over here, and in here he drew a Star of David. And then he said, "I'm going to give you something I never did before." He says, "I'm going to give you the entry into the universe." And I knew that he's a very good artist, and he could do that. And then he did this. This is the section right here. Here's a mountain range. And then here's some seagulls. And then here is a river going through that mountain with a sailboat. That's his sailboat. And then he said, then you're in the universe, and you're going through the universe, across the universe, into other lands. And there's a ship here with 36 men on it. And it's called, I forgot what he called it. There's a story in the Bible or in the Kabbalah or somewhere in a very high, you know, religious book. There's this story that he told me about. But then when he turned around, he turned into this position. He had another boy's face, eye, nose, lips, chin. As he was turning, he said, "There's a boy right here." It's the same face that was this lady here. But he got it, you know, he tied it in again. And then there's another face here. There's the eye, the nose, the lips, and the chin. And he drew five doves, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, with a star. And then he signed it, Max, M-A-X, 77. Peace. And then he was turning in this position now. And with the peace, he gave me these sailboats, which is serenity and peace. And then he ended it here with love to you. And this corner is three holy men.
Well, try it. From below, you were going to cut it.
I was going to cut it right from here. If we frame it around, everything is framed. You don't know how this thing moves around. We could hold up the weight, maybe. You know, four guys hold the corners.
There's five cuts there. Cut
it and go quick, maybe, yeah.
What do you think? You say this blade might
break? I think you probably break that blade.
Yeah, that's kind of... That's
but,
Well, I need that blade here.
Are you going to cut down these cuts? Is that... Which way did the joists run? This way?
This way.
That way. Mm-hmm. So how are you going to cut it? On the cut?
Yeah, I'm going to go right into the hole I just scored.
And then 2x8.
And I want to cut 2x4s.
They're 2x4s?
Yeah. Could I use that other blade that you have here?
I don't know.
No.
No, probably not.
Oh, yes, I can.
We'll give it a shot with the big one. The worst that happens, it breaks.
All right, okay.
Good, yeah.
That's
the
word.
Oh, you say? Yeah. You say good. Close. Yeah. You have a nice spot for it.
Yeah, it's going to be beautiful. Can we go on the ends rather than there?
Well, I guess we could.
Anything. Let's take it on the ends.
All we gotta do is just hold it up.
Yeah.
From the bottom, fellas.
We don't have a file up here, do we?
I think we can start that in the hole.
All right.
No problem. Yeah, it don't matter.
Okay, hand it up.
Well,
hold on, man. We got it. Yeah.
Top shelf. That center at 8 inches, which is the same thing that you
have. Fringe on.
Do you want to tighten that?
I guess he's got it.
Yeah.
Don't wait till we get down. Just come on.
There you go. Uh-huh. We see ya.
It looks beautiful. Here, I got another one. You know, gotta change the thing.
You got that?
Oh, that wire.
That was it.
That wire. Remember that fucking wire? Mm-hmm.
I remember the wire.
Yeah, no,
but
you
know
what?
It is.
You're way up over it. Yeah, because it was up there.
But,
This one, you gotta be careful, this one here. We're gonna make a mess if we're not.
There's a couple of cats down there.
I cut them.
They cut loose from this last joist?
Yeah.
And now they're added to the wall because...
You know. I cut them.
Jail,
I'm going to break up the sheet. easy. It's right here.
Safari.
Bravo! Bravo! Let's get high.
Really. It was pretty funny though. This guy wrote this song. The guy that I was playing with wrote this song. It was. It was great, actually. It was neat. I don't know if I can play it. I was starting to play this a few minutes ago. Anyway, it goes like, thank you, New York life. He's gonna love my kids, love my wife. Right? And he goes out. It was great. Everyone in the whole place was freaking out. They were applauding and jumping up and down. And they really thought it was great. It was, you know, it was weird. Thank you. can shuffle.
So it's going into your new house.
The new house.
You guys could work for the Metropolitan Museum of Art anytime.
You bet.
I'm sure.
Absolutely.
Especially with our fine craft.
Nancy, the best we're here tonight.
Just
I'm telling you. The
perfection.
Best.
Nancy,
best.
What did you go through for art today?
For art's sake. It's all for art, Bart. It's all for art, Bart. Let's sing that. It's all for art, Bart. It's all for art.
Well, it really turned out nice. I love the whole nice greenhouse.
Cut the rest of the roof off and build a greenhouse. Put some plants hanging up in there. Just frame this around, a couple plants around there.
Designer special.
So you know what?
We got to tell this guy something. You know what's going to happen? This guy's going to freak out when he walks in here and sees this. He's going to freak out. You know for sure. What's the guy's name?
Nick.
Nick's going to shit when he sees this.
That's what I'm thinking.
I've got five guys.
Good night, Eddie.
Okay, bye.
See you tomorrow. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Nice working with you.
Thanks, Mark. Thanks for coming, you know.
Spider Barbour. We're over here in the town of Hurley looking at gypsy moths. At this time of year, the gypsy moths are nestled into their little egg masses. The female moths have laid eggs, covered the eggs with the little tiny fuzz from their bodies, to form these odd little blobs. The gypsy moth is not a Native American insect. It was introduced into New England by an entomologist who thought that he could breed a better silkworm by mating gypsy moths with the traditional mulberry silkworm, an impossible task since they're not nearly closely related enough to be able to produce any sort of offspring whatsoever. But his little experimental charges escaped, and here they are all over the Northeast creating all these problems. However, the gypsy moth does have many natural enemies, native organisms, many insects, the native mice, native birds, but they're not able to keep up with the tremendous rise of a gypsy moth population that reaches a certain level and just accelerates year after year beyond any control organism's capacity to keep up with it, up until a point where it just reaches epidemic proportions. Then there are so many of them that certain disease organisms are able to take over, and within a couple of years the population drops tremendously and it disappears for many years, and it's hardly noticeable. But there are always gypsy moths in our woods, and it's only when they reach these tremendous numbers that people seem to take notice of them and realize that they're a problem. And some people may think that they're something new, but they're not. It's just that they normally are very low profile. Well, let's zoom in on some of the gypsy moth evidence that is present in the woods in the very early spring, actually throughout the winter until the eggs hatch out. And here is a little spot. These kind of spots are very typical on oak trees. A branch has died out, the bark is peeling away, leaving all these nice little nooks. This is a perfect spot for the caterpillars to pupate. And you see here, dangling from old silk, the old pupa cases from which the moths emerged last summer. Three females emerged here and deposited their egg masses, which are here, here, and here. These egg masses show evidence of parasitism by cryptogramma wasps and pecking by a bird, probably a chickadee. The tiny little holes are the holes from which these little nearly microscopic wasps emerged after eating the eggs as larvae themselves. When the wasps were larvae, they ate the gypsy moth eggs because the mother wasp laid eggs on the egg mass. And the bird pecked away at this portion of the egg mass and probably ate several dozen eggs. And this sort of thing chips away at the future gypsy moth population, but in a large population it doesn't serve to really prevent defoliation in the spring. However, as you can see, these egg masses are very accessible, and as long as they're low on the trees, it's easy for a person to get rid of them. And there are several ways this can be done. You can paint them with a substance like creosote, which will soak into the egg masses and gum up the eggs and produce toxins which will likely kill the caterpillars as they come out, or just kill the eggs outright. Or you can scrape the egg masses into a can of gasoline, or scrape them into a empty can and throw them in your wood stove when you have a fire going. There are all sorts of ways to destroy these little things, and since each one contains from 300 to 700 eggs, 300 to 700, let's say, you're getting rid of a lot more gypsy moths this way than if you went out stomping on caterpillars in the summertime. Let's scrape it upward and so that it flops into the can of gasoline. Take heed of the wind direction. It's very light, fluffy material. Now, right there in, oh, maybe 15 seconds, we got rid of probably at least a couple of thousand gypsy moths. And not all so easy, and some of them undoubtedly will escape. But that's all right. We're simply bringing the population down to a reasonable level, a level that we can live with. Well, there certainly are a lot of them here. This maybe is not the best tool for the job, but it's something we picked up, just a found object. In any case, you see how easy and painless and safe this method is. No toxic sprays. Just a can of gas and the appropriate tool. It's been proposed that the $75,000 that's allotted for spraying the area would be better spent hiring egg mass hunters. I agree. I think this would probably be a more effective way of reducing the gypsy moth population, provided that the egg hunters were good at what they were doing. And just on the off chance that they might actually go through with this, who knows? Let's see where these egg masses are hidden, the unusual places that we can find them. They're not always on tree trunks. In fact, if a tree trunk is as smooth as this, it's very unlikely that you'll find any egg masses unless it's just an enormous gypsy moth population. They like to hide their little cases. For example, a large boulder in the woods with some underhanging edges amongst nasty briars. Ah. Nevertheless, it's the lot of the egg hunter to suffer through these brambles because under here, many pupae. Down here, a very large gypsy moth egg mass. And here are more of them. More. See, here's a very large old pupa case, a nice, big, healthy female emerged from that. Now, why would a gypsy moth lay eggs on a rock? Certainly nothing there for the caterpillars to eat. Doesn't matter.
where the eggs are laid, because when the caterpillars hatch out, they will crawl around for many days. They don't need to eat right away. They'll climb as high as they can, and they'll just jump off. And they will have attached a lifeline of silk to their point of takeoff. And they're so light that they'll drift on the breeze along with this little line of silk trailing behind them until they land on a leaf that's the sort of leaf that they like to eat. The young gypsy moth caterpillars are relatively picky about what they will eat. They prefer to eat young oak leaves. And there aren't many other things that they'll eat. As they grow older, they learn that they can't always get the kind of leaves that are really tasty, or perhaps they just develop a digestive system that can stomach a lot more different kinds of leaves. In any event, by the time they get big enough to notice, they'll eat almost any sort of leaf. There are very, very few things that they won't eat. And this is why, if there are a lot of oak forests, the little caterpillars will have enough food to eat during their early stages to reach the point where they can eat a lot more kinds of leaves, and then they'll go on and eat those. And this is what we had last year. Obviously, if there were less oaks, if the forest had a different composition, the little caterpillars would have less to eat, and there would be fewer large caterpillars. Of course, that's a pretty strange way of controlling them. Let's change the forest composition. But with good forest management practices, this actually could be done. If we made a lot more use of the oaks and hickories as firewood, for example, and tried to shift the forest composition toward a maple beech ash dominance, you'd see a lot less gypsy moths. So, let's move on and look to some other places. What have we here? Gorgeous egg mass there. What a big one. That would have a record number of eggs in it. Look at, I would venture to say that's the remnants of the mother of this. There's many stories on this old board. This is a pupa that's been infected by some sort of mold. It was killed. It's not much left of it. Some gook inside. Here's a caterpillar that seems to have been killed by this same white mold. Several of them, in fact. Down here, we have some moths, some old moths, a female moth, perhaps the very moth that hatched from this big pupa and deposited this big egg mass. So, in tearing apart these old wooden structures, whatever you may have, you'll find many of these egg masses. This is a really big one. And you can pick up what's left. It looks like foam insulation. With little tapioca balls in it. Catskill caviar.
Okay.
Wow, it's been a good winter for your garden. Had snow cover during the really cold spell, and now the frost is out of the ground, and you can see what survived. Here's an old carrot that we missed. And I see over here an old chard leaf. Very green, very healthy. You may wonder whether the gypsy moth caterpillars are going to come in and eat all your tomatoes and lettuce and carrots and peas and celery after they've finished off the trees. Well, they don't like garden plants, so that's nothing to worry about. Maybe the defoliation will give your garden a little more sun. See, there's always something positive to look for in these things. But there's something a little sinister and negative about the sprays that they propose to use. Some of them I don't think you'd want in your garden. Let's take a look at the one that's considered the safest, the BT. The BT stands for Bacillus thuringiensis, which is a bacteria that lives in the soil. It's not, by the way, a disease that infects gypsy moth caterpillars. Although it's a bacteria, all the bacteria does is to incidentally produce a substance that just happens to give gypsy moth caterpillars a horrible stomach ache. In fact, enough of it will kill them. What they don't tell you about BT is what else is in it. Sure, it doesn't kill anything except caterpillars. Which is of some concern to me, since there are a lot of caterpillars that I would like to keep around. But most people aren't interested in that. But you will be interested in this. In order to make BT effective as a spray, it has to be mixed with a substance which will allow it to vaporize and stick to the leaves when it falls on them. Usually what they use is a substance called xylene. This is a substance that causes cancer in laboratory animals. Now, this testing of animals, obviously you're not going to test people to see whether something gives them cancer. So you can only use rats and things like that. And you may say, well, just because it causes cancer in rats, it's not going to cause cancer in me. But every substance that causes cancer in humans has been tested on laboratory animals, and it gives them cancer. This is across the board, 100%. The reverse is difficult to establish simply because you can't experiment on humans. But I think it's safe to assume that if a substance gives cancer to an animal, it's very likely to do the same thing to you. Okay. Let's consider this new spray that they're going to use this year, Dilox. The active ingredient in this is trichlorfan. This substance has been tested, and in the early tests, it seemed to be safe. Now, these tests are being touted about as proof of its safety. Another thing that's being said about it is that it's used as a medicine in treating people for some sort of stomach disease, I believe. Just because something's a medicine doesn't mean that it's safe. Everybody knows that medicines used in the wrong way or in the wrong dosage can be extremely dangerous. Any medicine's a very potent substance. You know the story about the gold that was used in the treatment of cancer patients that's been sold on the black market, turns up in rings, and now they're worried that it might cause cancer. This sort of two sides of the coin is a very common thing. Now, more recent tests on Dilox have shown it to cause a variety of carcinogenic and mutagenic effects. It's caused certain kinds of tumors in animals. It's caused sperm mutations that result in birth defects. In other words, it's not as safe as they say, and it seems to have a lot of potential for damage. This is why I don't think you'd like to get it on your garden vegetables. And certainly a lot of those vegetables are going to be in season just at the time when they propose to spray, which would be in May and June, when a lot of the early vegetables are up and you're harvesting your lettuce and putting it in your salad every night and you're bringing in your peas. These are the vegetables that will get hit by this stuff, and they're vegetables that you eat raw from the garden. There's no cooking. You're going to get the full dose, in other words. So before you sign this form about the spray, think about these things. Think about the fact that you can do something about the gypsy moth around your own property. Get rid of the egg masses. You can put rings on the trees when the caterpillars are out. There are all sorts of very effective ways of reducing the population at least as much as the spray will, and before the caterpillars actually do their damage. The sprays are, you know, applied to the caterpillars while they're in the active phase of eating. In other words, quite a bit of the damage has already been done by the time they spray. And certainly it's better to nip them in the bud than to wait until the damage is done.
Not really, when you stop to think that I didn't start the El Salvador thing. I inherited it. And the previous administration, which probably was as vociferous as anyone in talking about my threat to peace, they were doing what we're doing, sending aid to El Salvador, of the same kind of aid that we're sending. So I don't think that I'm doing anything that warrants that charge. Well, I didn't think I warranted it before, and I've been here more than 6 weeks now and haven't fired a shot.
So to me, and remember to me, there's a Zoom. Whenever you want to use the Zoom, you could use the Zoom, right? Okay. So here we are. I feel a lot of different kind of feelings from this. I feel most really good. I mean, it's been maybe 6 years of, how many years? It's been 5 years since it's been up, and that I've been thinking of what will happen the day I have to move out of this building. How in the heck am I going to get this thing down? But it certainly felt like an event and still does to me. I feel that there's a lot of questions as to its worth. I'd like to be able to say I don't care, but I do. But that's not the whole thing. I mean, it's, if nothing more, a friend of mine drew a picture on a ceiling, and I think it's real pretty. I really love it. I fell in love with the picture, and when I decided that I really found myself in love with it, then that's when I knew that I really wanted it, and so it didn't matter how much it took to take it down. So, and then all these guys coming together, you know, Peter Lechnowitz and Johnny Andriadakis and Albert Prey and Eddie, and we all got together, and the feeling, and Timmy, and the feeling that's behind it, it was so good, it was worthwhile doing anyway, I don't care what happens. But it left a hole in the ceiling. I don't know what the new owners are going to do about that. I have no idea. But I told them there was something upstairs. If I sell you the building, there's something upstairs I have to take with me. And we never really got into it. And I'm going to build a frame. The next thing to do is going to build a frame, put a glass in front of it, turn it the other way so that you'll be able to see the what it is there, because it's upside down. And it's going to be beautiful. It fits right in, takes up the room it's supposed to take up, my little place. I have a wood stove keeping me warm. I got a Peter Max painting behind me. I'm burning maybe 6 watts of electricity at all times. No big deal, very low profile, but a special kind of thing. I have a stream running in the back of the house. I guess it's one of the nicest places I've ever been in for me. I love it here. So for the next 6 months, you can reach me here, and then after that, we'll see what goes on. I'm going where the painting goes.
Okay.
Thanks for coming, Nancy.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night. Thank you. Oh, 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 long. Right on. Don't be maybe. So long. Way down.
You're watching Channel 6 in Woodstock. Our national anthem.